Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, all over the world. On behalf of the Pancreaticobiliary Committee of the World Endoscopy Organization, I'd like to welcome you to this webinar on ERCP cannulation and prevention of complications. I'm Nageshwar Reddy from Hyderabad, India, and co-chairing this session with me is Dr. Lars Aabakken from Norway and Dong-Wan CEO from Korea. As you can see from this program, we have structured in such a way that you have three very important talks initially, which deal with the technique of selective cannulation, ERCP in a surgically altered anatomy, and complications of ERCP and how to prevent them. Following these three talks and a brief Q&A, we have a live demonstration from the AAG hospitals, where for the next 45 minutes, we'll try and demonstrate these techniques of cannulation of both easy and difficult cases. And I'm sure that in this period, we'll have a lot of learning points to come up. And I'd like to welcome you all again on behalf of the World Endoscopy Organization, the Pancreaticobiliary Committee. Thank you very much. So we'll start with the first talk, and I'll ask Dong-Wan CEO to welcome our first speaker and start the proceeding.
Well, actually, I will do that since it's our European friend Jörg Albert from Germany, who will discuss. So that we can try to pick up most of the questions. There will be 5 minutes of Q&A after each of these three talks. So please, Jörg.
Yes, thank you, Lars, very much for the introduction. It's a great honor and a great pleasure to present ERCP cannulation and the technique of selective cannulation. And I want to focus on the deep biliary cannulation. So let's start. First of all, the native papilla is for the experienced ERCPist. This slides here shows that sphincterotypy is much easier to do and stone removal much easier to do than intubation of the native papilla, which takes at least 200 ERCP to cope with a success rate of about 70% to intubate the native papilla. So it's for the advanced ERCPist. But of course, we have to learn it, and to learn intubation of the native papilla, we have to know where it is to be found. And anatomy tells us that it's between 3.5 centimeters behind the pylorus up to 10 centimeters behind the pylorus. This is what the anatomists tell us. And of course, mostly we find a papilla with the duodenoscope just with positioning before it. And here it is with the typical folds. And here is the major papilla. There are some variations of the combination of the orifice and of the bile duct and the pancreatic duct. So there might be some kind of an ampulla, as to be shown here. There might be a separate orifices of the pancreatic and the common bile duct. And there might be this rare variation of a long common channel. And of course, there are different kind of percentages to be found in these anatomic variations. But even if this one is rare, it is important because, like in this case, it's not so much of interest in this case what has been done to deliver here, but there is someone putting a balloon catheter down in the to the level of the papilla, injecting a lot of contrast just to obfuscate the common bile duct. But as you see here, with the long common channel, also the pancreatic duct was opacified, which was not, which was a bad idea because it was not wanted to put contrast into the pancreatic duct. It should have been avoided, but with a long common channel, you always have to keep in mind that this problem might occur. Please opacify on the level of the middle of the compile duct, maybe. Of course, we have to now our materials, our catheters and papillotomes. In many cases, the papillotome will be the first chase together with a guide wire. And there might be some special kind of papillotomes like this needle knife or Bilworth 2 variation of a papillotome. And then they differ from the length of the nose. There is some part of the nose before the guide wire, the cutting wire starts. Here the wire is until the tip of the catheter. So there are two golden rules to keep in mind before starting to cannulate. And the first one is positioning, positioning, positioning. This is very important to be in an a relaxed position before the papilla. Keep your time to advance the duodenoscope. Don't try to put the endoscope in this kind of awkward position, but relaxed position before the papilla is important to have a relaxed intervention. And the second golden rule is consider the siphon. I don't know if you have ever heard of the siphon. The siphon is this here, and it is important also for ERCP because it is meaning this kind of S-type shape of the transpapillar part of the common bile duct here. So this is difficult to advance a guide wire if you get stuck here in the lower part of the papilla. So you need to intubate the lower part of the papilla and then retract the endoscope together with the material as here, and then open this S-type shape until you can advance the guide wire, like it is shown here in this very old, sorry for this, very old ERCP video. Advancing the guide wire, then retracting a little bit the endoscope, turning it, and then opacifying. The guide wire has been done formally the last many years ago. Now we will use the guide wire first in most cases. That's why this video is so old. The technique today is a little different, but now the guide wire will be advanced very easily into the common bile duct right here. The S shape has been opened, and this is how it will be mastered, the siphon. To access the biliary system, there are different kind of approaches that are possible. You can use simple cannula. You may use a papillotome, mostly together with the guide wire. And there are some techniques to help if you intend to access the biliary system, but get your wire all. In the pancreatic duct, I'll show you what. And if it's not simple, simple technique, then pre-cut technique is needed. Please take your time before intubating the papilla. Suck a little bit the air out of the duodenum to reduce the tension, then you will be able to identify the orifice. Maybe some bile comes out, and with contrast-saving technique, you can advance the guide wire into the papilla. And important is to align the endoscope together with the cannula and the guide wire with the axis of the common bile duct to successfully intubate it. And we are avoiding to put contrast in mostly today. Why that? Because it increases risks, as we will hear later. But second, it also may sometimes, as you see here, be the reason for completely injecting contrast into the mucosa, and then it's getting awkward and awful to succeed in ERCP. So avoid contrast, use guide wire first technique. I hope everybody is hearing me still. There is some, hope there's no problem with the connection. With the papillotome, we have an advantage over the cannula, because with bending the papillotome, we may help ourselves to align the catheter into the axis of the common bile duct, and it might be easier to get the guide wire in if you need use a guide wire together with the papillotome in this technique as shown here. So this will be the first choice in many cases. But as I already mentioned, sometimes it's difficult to access the common bile duct first. Sometimes the guide wire just flips into the pancreatic duct in voluntarily, but sometimes it's easier to keep the guide wire in the pancreatic duct if we intubated that, and then use a second guide wire, as is shown here. First guide wire in the pancreatic duct, and then the second guide wire is more easy advanced into the common bile duct if the pancreatic wire is kept in place. By that, it helps to straighten the S shape of the transduodenal part of the common bile duct, and in the end, we may place a pancreatic stent into the pancreatic duct. This is like crossing the fingers if you look it with the video. One guide wire in the pancreatic duct and the other one in the common bile duct, and it always helps to orientate correctly the axis of the common bile duct axis. It's like crossing your fingers with crossing the guide wires as you see it here. So if simple advances as these don't succeed, we sometimes need pre-cut papillotomy. And pre-cut, of course, has also to be learned, and it is a technique for the experienced ERCPist. And different kind of techniques are available here. First, there is the technique to, if you intubated a pancreatic duct, you may cut a little bit into the direction of the common bile duct, which is called transpancreatic pre-cutting. Then there's a conventional pre-cut with the needle knife cutting into the direction of the common bile duct from the orifice. And then there is fistulotomy, which is maybe the favorite needle knife technique, because it is apart from the orifice of the pancreatic duct, might lessen pancreatitis and helps to open the orifice similarly successful as conventional pre-cut technique. And there also are in use in some clinics these kind of short nose papillotomes, or most often the wires up to the tip of the catheter. In other clinics, it's the needle knife, which is used in for pre-cut technique. So why not cutting into the direction of the common bile duct if the pancreatic duct has already been intubated? It might also controverse if this might increase the risk of pancreatitis, but in experienced hands, it holds a high degree of success and might help to achieve deep biliary cannulation. Then there is conventional needle knife technique. I call it mostly the freestyle technique, from the orifice upwards, cutting the papilla and opening the papilla. This helps to open the common bile duct and to show and to help to intubate the deeply the common bile duct afterwards. And then there is the fistulotomy technique with putting the needle knife above the orifice of the common bile duct. Especially in these kind of bulging papillas, it's well used and maybe less complicating as a classical needle knife papillotomy, and that's why the ESGE recommends needle knife fistulotomy as the preferred technique for pre-cutting. There's also, of course, the option to use the stent within the pancreatic duct as a helping structure to open the papilla, maybe with the needle knife, as seen here. Very helpful sometimes with cutting over the pancreatic duct. So, do you want to be successful? There are also, then you have to keep in mind also some soft facts, which is please always consider the indication of the procedure. Be careful that all information is available that's needed. I recommend a team time out before starting. So, including to identify the patient, the indication, and to be sure that everything that is needed is within reach, and be sure that the atmosphere within the operating room is relaxed. You need sympathetic communication with everybody, which helps you to succeed in the procedure in the end. There are some medications which may be used to help to intubate the native papilla, but in my experience, it is rarely needed to use those. And change of the operator is, of course, your choice. If you're not that experienced, please call for help if you need help in intubating the papillary. And of course, there are alternatives like PDCD, bilioduodenostomy, biliogastrostomy, rendezvous procedures, either by EUS or PDC. And most of these, of course, are for the experienced interventionalist. So for summing up my lecture, there is this algorithm to be presented, which comes from the ESG guidelines, evidence-based algorithm for selective bile duct cannulation. Guide wire cannulation with a standard sphincterotome is recommended as the first choice. And you have to consider after five attempts, after 5 or 5 minutes, trying to intubate the common bile duct and not succeeding, either in case you unintentionally intubated a pancreatic guide the pancreatic duct, then either do it and thereby succeeding common bile duct cannulation, or needle knife fistulotomy or transpancreatic biliary sphincterotomy, as I showed you previously, and with no pancreatic access, pre-cut is recommended here to succeed in this procedure. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope the connection was okay. And thank you for the attention.
So thank you very much, Jörg. That was very comprehensive. I think it covered most of the, the crucial points we need to consider. I was wondering, you talked a little bit about this, the siphon thing and other specific sort of anatomical issues. There has been some discussion about sort of the appearance of the papilla and whether that can sort of help you understand what problems to face and what strategy to choose. Do you have any comments on that? Do you think the appearance of the papilla helps you make the decisions?
Of course, there is a huge variety of different kind of papillary configurations. And I think it is highly recommended to take your time before the papilla and to try to identify if there is a separate orifice of the common bile duct and the pancreatic duct. So take your time to try to identify the orifices. Of course, this helps to get an idea of the anatomy and to help you to identify the correct alignment of the axis of the common bile duct to your endoscope and to your cannula, and then you will succeed.
Okay. We had one question from the question and answer box, but I think Sundeep will address that specific issue later on, so I think we'll keep that. Anything from your side, Dong-Wan?
It was a good lecture to touch various aspects of selective cannulation. If I ask you a bit of question, what is your most preferred approach by yourself? In terms of accessories, are you starting with regular cannula most of the times, or sphincterotome, or with wire first, and not using any contrast? I want to hear your own approach.
Yes, my own approach is to use the papillotome together with the guide wire. So in almost all of our ERCPs now, we don't do diagnostic ERCP anymore. So we do therapeutic intervention, and we are planning to do stone extraction or insertion of a stent, metal stent or plastic stent. And so we are planning to do treatment. And with the sphincterotome, we are ready to open the sphincter if you need sphincterotomy for that. But also the sphincterotome gives me the additional advantage to have an additional option to bend it, and thereby improving the correct position of the catheter of the sphincterotome before the papilla, so to optimally intubate the common bile duct. And if I always get into the pancreatic duct, then in fact I try to cut with a short cut over the pancreatic duct into the common bile duct, which, as I told you, is controversial, but in many cases is successfully to be done. The alternative is to keep the guide wire within the pancreatic duct and then use a second guide wire, which is always frequently done here in my unit.
Okay,
thank you. I'm also using transpancreatic septotomy or pre-cut oftentimes. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think having the access to the pancreatic duct with something, if you have that, you should consider keeping it, because it can be quite helpful. I think even in the situation, which was one question again from the Q&A about the specifics of intradiverticular papilla, any specific tips and tricks there? I think a pancreatic wire is one.
The pancreatic wire, if you get into the pancreatic duct, is helpful with the juxtapapillary diverticulum. I may show you pictures, but there is also the option to use sometimes, if it's really difficult to use the with the papilla. Do you see the pictures here? Sometimes it's yes. On the rim of the diverticulum, then it's easier to intubate, but sometimes it's really not to get access if the papilla is within the diverticulum, and sometimes it helps to evert the diverticulum, maybe with clipping it here on the side. You have to be very careful, of course, not to clip the bile duct itself or the orifice itself, but it helps to evert the diverticulum a little bit. And also there are some injection techniques which sometimes help you. So diverticulum sometimes is challenging in my experience, but most often with taking your time, you will succeed.
I think one final question may be, because you mentioned the transpancreatic sphincterotomy, and Dong-Wan also does that, and so do I, to be honest. It's one participant asking whether we know enough about the long-term complications and whether you'd need to put the pancreatic stent after the transpancreatic sphincterotomy, which is a very relevant question, I think.
Yes, I think, as you already mentioned, Lars, with the excess of the pancreatectomy, we shall keep it. And in most cases, I would place a small, very small pancreatic stent, maybe 5 French only, very soft one, with side holes and without an inner flap. That's our pancreatic stent in these cases for prophylactic stenting. And if you are using this kind of stent, you won't damage the pancreatic duct, so you will help the patient to reduce risk of pancreatitis. And I would place such a stent in the end in the pancreatic duct.
Okay. So I think in the interest of time, thank you so much again, Jörg. That was excellent discussion as well. And we'll move on to the next speaker, which I know very well since he works in my unit. Christel Tønnesen from Oslo, Norway, has quite some experience over the years in ERCP and the specifics of surgically altered anatomy. So Christel, please.
Thank you, Lars, for that very kind introduction. And thank you for the invitation. I'm very excited to discuss with you and talk about the challenges we face when we need to do ERCP in a patient with a surgical altered anatomy. And I would like to focus this talk on the navigation, let me just see here, on the navigation of an altered anatomical landscape with the arthroscope, and how to gain bile duct access. I would also like to demonstrate some interventional possibilities. Before starting out performing ERCP in a case of surgical altered anatomy, you should have a roadmap on how to reach the bile duct with the endoscope. And it's important to review past surgical reports and endoscopy reports whenever they are available. And you should also have a thorough understanding of the various surgical techniques that are used for reconstructing the gastrointestinal tract. So first, let's have a look at the bilirubin 2 resection, which involves the resection of the distal stomach and the duodenal bulb, and then followed by an upward mobilization of a jejunal loop to create an end-to-side gastrojejunostomy. And if you keep in mind that some surgeons also perform, say, Brown's anastomosis to reduce bile reflux. So most of these cases are accessible with a duodenoscope, which is the preferred option to an enteroscope for easier handling and also has more therapeutic approaches. So, but take care when you approach the ligament arthritis not to use excessive force as it might induce a perforation. So instead, you could consider to advance a guide wire and a catheter through the triad band to straighten the course of the bowel limb and facilitate the deep intubation of the duodenum. And once in the duodenum, you will face the papilla in an upside down orientation. And we use a straight catheter and not a sphincterotome, which will only bend in the opposite direction of the bile duct. So as you can see, this patient had large stones. So we placed the straight plastic stent to facilitate a safe sphincterotomy with a needle knife, followed by a large balloon sphincteroplasty. And then we were able to crush the stones with a basket and remove the fragments. Okay, let's move on to the Whipple procedure, which involves the resection of the pancreatic head together with the distal bile duct and the duodenum. and which is followed by the upward mobilization of the remaining jejunum to create a pancreatical jejunostomy and a hepatical jejunostomy and an end-to-side gastrojejunostomy sequentially on the same bowel limb. Now, most of these cases do require to use an enteroscope. We use balloon enteroscopes for these procedures. And a specific challenge may be to locate the hepatical jejunostomy orifice among all the jejunal folds. But in the absence of a papillary sphincter, air will often seep into the bile duct, which is seen as an air cholangiogram on X-ray. And you can utilize fluoroscopic guidance for locating the hepatical jejunostomy orifice, as with this case. And the hepatical jejunostomy orifice might be severely stenotic, as with this case, which is only seen as a very minuscule opening on a submucosal scar. So fortunately, we were able to cannulate this orifice with a guide wire and were able to advance the catheter over the guide wire. And we subsequently did a balloon dilation. If the hepatical jejunostomy is astenotic and you're not able to advance a catheter, you could consider just to make a small incision with a needle knife to allow the passage of a catheter. Okay, let's proceed to the wound Y procedures, which involves several techniques for reconstruction of the GI tract, which all shares a common principle, which is the transection of the jejunum, followed by an upward mobilization of the distal part of the small bowel, which is now called the roux limb. And the roux limb is used to create an anastomosis either with a bile duct, a hepatical jejunostomy, or the proximal GI tract, most commonly the proximal part of the stomach, a gastrojejunostomy. And after this anastomosis is created, a side-to-side anastomosis is created between the remaining proximal jejunum and the distal portion of the roux limb. So the Roux Y hepatical jejunostomies are commonly used for managing bile duct injuries following cholecystectomy injuries, and also for bile duct resections and even liver transplants. Whereas the Roux Y gastrojejunostomy is used for reconstructions following gastrectomies. And probably the most common utilization of Roux Y surgery today is the Roux Y gastric bypass, which is very similar to the Roux Y gastrectomy. Besides that, for this procedure, the stomach is transected and not resected, and the roux limb is much longer. So the endoscopic route from the gastric pouch to the duodenum is typically more than 2 meters, which makes these cases especially challenging for the endoscopist. So a critical step in ERCP with a Roux Y anatomy is the navigation through the jejunojejunostomy and to identify the biliary limb across the anastomosis. So looking to the left for the hepatical jejunostomy, you are approaching this anastomosis coming from the duodenum and the proximal jejunum. And you are crossing over to the roux limb to access the biliary limb and head towards the hepatical jejunostomy. Whereas for the Roux Y gastrectomy and gastric bypass scenario, you are approaching the hepatical jejunostomy, the jejunal jejunostomy coming from the roux limb, and you are crossing over the anastomosis to enter into the proximal jejunum and the duodenum to approach the native papilla. And the endoscopic appearance in both these scenarios are quite similar. You are faced with 3 bowel limbs and you need to identify the one which will take you towards the bile duct. So let's first have a look at the Roux Y hepatical jejunostomy situation. So this is the patient we had, and you can appreciate there is 3 bowel limbs present. There is 2 straight ahead and 1 more angulated to the left. And the first thing you need to do is to identify the anastomotic line, as you can see quite clearly on this image. So this is the border between the 2 limbs which are joined on this side-to-side anastomosis. So to the upper right, you will find the continuation of the limb that you are coming from. Limb A will be a short and blind limb, whereas across the anastomotic line, you will find limb B, which will take you towards the colon, whereas the most angulated limb across the anastomosis is the root limb taking you towards the hepaticojejunostomy. But you should keep in mind that sometimes the surgeons, they create this anastomosis with a reverse orientation or so-called antiperistaltic orientation, which dramatically changes this scenario. So now, as you can see, C is no longer the way to the bile duct. It's the long and winding road towards the colon. So whenever you are intubating what you believe is the biliary limb and you're not making any progress and you have intubated for, let's say, more than a meter and you don't see any bowel air fluoroscopy in the upper right quadrant, consider heading back and head for the other limb across the anastomotic line. We see this orientation in about 10% of our cases. So in this, let's move on to the same scenario for the Roux-en-Y gastric bypass and gastrectomy case. So in this situation, you will face a very similar endoscopic appearance. So yet again, you're faced with three limbs. And again, you need to identify the anastomotic line, which we can see here. So as you can see, limb A will be the continuation of the root limb you are coming from, which will take you towards the colon. Whereas crossing the anastomotic line, you will find a short and blind limb. And the most angulated limb is most commonly the way towards the duodenum and the native papilla. But also for this situation, you might have a reverse orientation of the anastomosis. But in this situation, it doesn't make a big difference because you will immediately recognize this when you intubate the short and blind loop across the anastomotic line. And then you immediately know you need to choose the other limb across the anastomotic line. So whenever cannulating a native papilla with an enteroscope, the first thing I try to do is to straighten the scope and reduce loop formation, which will simplify the scope handling. And will also simplify the introduction of accessory through the working channels of the scope. And we use a distal cap to facilitate the negotiation of the papilla. And we try to position the papilla on the left side, which is in line with the enteroscope working channel. So the first thing you need to try is to obtain a foothold with a catheter within the ampulla, and try to align the catheter with the bile duct and advance the guide wire into the bile duct, as we just learned. And this patient had a stone. And whenever performing a sphincterotomy with the enteroscope, a regular sphincterotome, the bow-style sphincterotome, is not really helpful because you can't control the bending orientation of the catheter. So we use a needle knife alongside the wire in this manner. And thereafter, we perform a balloon sphincteroplasty and choose the balloon size according to the duct size. So in this case, we were able to sweep the stone with a balloon. And you can also use baskets for stone removal. But unfortunately, there are no crushing baskets available for enteroscopes. But in the case when you have a sufficiently dilated common bile duct and you perform a large balloon sphincteroplasty, you might be able to introduce the tip of the enteroscope into the common bile duct. That's with this patient who had a very large stone. And we were able to advance an electrohydraulic lithotripsy probe through the working channel of the enteroscope and successfully crush the stone. And thereafter, we were able to remove the fragments. And nor are self-expandable metal stands available for enteroscope. So this was a patient with a gastric bypass anatomy. And we were able to advance a guide wire into the bile duct. And thereafter, we withdrew the enteroscope, leaving the overtube in place with an inflated balloon. And thereafter, we introduce the stent delivery system over the wire through the overtube and advance the delivery system into the bile duct. And thereafter, we deploy the stent with fluoroscopic guidance. So finally, I would just like to mention some alternatives for wound Y gastric bypass ERCP, which does not involve to use an arthroscope. So one is the laparoscopy assisted ERCP. So with laparoscopy, a large caliber trocar is introduced through the abdominal wall and into the excluded stomach to enable the introduction of a duodenoscope through the trocar into the excluded stomach and further into the duodenum. And in this position, ERCP can be conducted in a more or less regular manner. And at Oslo University Hospital, we have two endoscopy units, one which performs laparoscopy assisted ERCP and the other balloon arthroscopy assisted ERCP. So we conducted a comparison between these two procedures, which show that the overall success rate was somewhat better with the laparoscopic approach, whereas the balloon arthroscopy approach had a lesser rate of adverse events. So at our institution, we select those patients who also need a cholecystectomy for laparoscopy assisted ERCP, in which the two procedures can be performed concomitantly, whereas those, the remainder of patients are referred for balloon arthroscopy assisted ERCP. And the last method I would like to show to you is the EDGE procedure for gastric bypass ERCP, which utilizes an echo endoscope to introduce a lumen-opposing metal stent with diathermy to make a temporary anastomosis between the gastric pouch and the excluded stomach, which enables the advancement of an duodenoscope through the patient's mouth and through the stent into the excluded stomach to perform ERCP in a regular manner. So the limitation of this procedure is the risk of stent dislodgement during the scope intubation. And also a recent paper also described that 10% of the patients develop a chronic fistula after stent removal. And also this procedure, it has a high cost of devices, the stents, and also possibly closure devices. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you, Chris. That was truly, truly excellent. Lots of good points. So as you mentioned, there are some alternative methods, depending probably on your local expertise and availability. But if you were to start doing ERCP in gastric bypass patients and had none of the methods available, which one do you think you would choose from scratch if you did not have early other experience?
So you mean if you don't have any experience with general small bowel arthroscopy?
Yeah.
In that case, I would say it would be a better option to start performing laparoscopy assisted ERCP. Because especially with the gastric bypass patients, the intubation to the duodenum is quite challenging. And our data show that in those cases, we were not able to successfully perform ERCP. Half of those cases was due to a failed intubation. And if you don't have any prior experience with arthroscopy, it will be very challenging. So I would start with performing arthroscopy in general before thinking about doing ERCP for gastric bypass cases.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right, because I think the competence, the laparoscopic competence to place a trocar and the subsequent ERCP are not that difficult. So it's probably an easier method in hospitals where you don't really already have the arthroscopic expertise. Any comments from your side, Dong-Wan? You would do EUS guided, of course. You unmute yourself. Unmute.
Ah, yes. Sorry. It was wonderful talk. In Asia, especially Far East Asia, we previously had a lot of stones in the intrahepatic tree. So we developed the technical percutaneous approach. So if the duct is dilated, we are not hesitating to do PTBD and percutaneous transhepatic cholangioscopy and doing some procedures. If there is stone, we are using that. So the according to the different lesions, I think the preferred approach can be different. Yes, US guided approach is becoming popular these days, but still we need to do more study on this aspect. My question is, there is a question about from the audience, how can we identify A loop and the E loop? And what is the complication rate during ERCP in surgically altered anatomy, and what should what kind of aspect we should be very careful to prevent those complications?
So the first question was, how can you identify the different limbs within the jejunojejunostomy of a gastric bypass patient? Was that the question?
Yes, yes.
So let me just go back to the slide that I presented. Let me see. So you mean this situation? How can you know for sure where you are?
Mm-hmm.
So the thing you need to do is to identify this anastomotic line, which is the scar which is formed when you join these two limbs together in a side-to-side anastomosis. And if you are able to see this anastomotic line, it's completely circular. It runs around the total circumference here, and it separates the two limbs in this anastomosis. So you can see this limb to the left is the continuation of the limb that you're coming from. It's the continuation of the root limb. So you would identify that first as limb A, which will take you towards the colon. But if you cross the anastomotic line, you will go over to the other limb, which is the proximal jejunum. And most commonly, the limb which is heading towards the duodenum is the most angulated limb across this line. And if you go across this anastomotic line and you will intubate the other limb, which is B, you will immediately recognize that that's a blind limb. So you will be able to identify the blind limb. That's what I actually mostly do in these cases. I first identify the blind limb, and then you know absolutely 100% of certainty that it's the other limb, which is the correct way towards the duodenum. It might be difficult to assess, so this is a critical step. So I most often I use some time to navigate and to understand the anastomosis. I use some time to flush, and I normally administer some buscopain to sort of calm the peristaltic stealthic movement. And most of the cases, you're able to make a decision on which limb you are heading for in the majority of cases, and you can be certain that you are heading in the right direction. So that was one. And the other question was that how can you reduce
complication?
So we have experienced a somewhat higher rate of post-pancreatic pancreatitis. Post-ERCP pancreatitis in our patients. And we know that obese patients, they have a higher risk of pancreatitis following ERCP, which is established. But we also think that the method we use with doing a needle knife sphincterotomy and a sphincteroplasty is probably also something which adds somewhat to the risk of pancreatitis. But I think it's important to use the same principles as was previously discussed. So we use guide wire cannulation, and we try not to pre-inject. So I guess that's the most important aspect in that regard. I don't know if you have anything to add to that, Lars.
No, I think that's exactly right. And you need experience, and this, your pictures are very clear. I mean, those videos are selected because they show your principles very well, but really sometimes it's certainly not as easy. And one option then, particularly for hepatic jejunostomies, is to try one, and after not too long, your air enterogram will, and the direction of the scope will tell you if you are in the right direction or not, and then you can leave a cannula, pull back your scope, and then pick the other limb. I think that's sometimes reasonable as well if the overview is very poor.
Yes, yes. Generally, when we do ERCP in altered anatomy, the AROOP angle is relatively difficult to go because there is usually a little bit of angulation, but the ELOOP goes easily. That's just one way, but it's very crude way of differentiation. And sometimes you can see some bile is coming from one loop that is generally AROOP. And as you mentioned, we can use pleuro also. And after full insertion, try to see the direction of the tip of the duodenoscope, which way it is going. If it's approaching to the right upper quadrant area, that is the area ailing resides. Or sometimes when we are inserting our scope, we can do some biopsy to see, to put marking on the one side of the limb. And if it fails, then you can try the other limb. Yes?
Yeah. Okay. I think.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. And, I think because of the time, we need to move on to the next talk. It is next talk will be delivered by Professor Anthony Teoh, and the title is Potential Complications and Prevention. If I introduce Anthony briefly, he is currently associate professor in Chinese University of Hong Kong and the deputy director of Endoscopy Center. He graduated from Chinese University of Hong Kong in the year 2001, and he did a lot of overseas training, including Kitasato University East Hospital and the Cancer Institute in Ariake, and the University of Washington, Cornell University, and Stanford University. And his main research interest is interventional EUS and ERCP, minimally invasive upper GI cancer surgery. His background is actually surgeon. Anthony, are you ready?
Thank you. So thank you very much, Professor Dong-Wan, and also Lars and Nagi in the kind invitation. So to follow the series of lectures, I'll be talking about prevention and management of adverse events of ERCP. When we look at ERCP, how to prevent complications, then of course we need to know what sort of complications that we will encounter. So from early on, Peter Cotton's initial description of complications of ERCP in 11,000 patients, the highest rate is actually pancreatitis, 2.6%. Bleeding is around 0.3%, infection is 0.3%, and all others are relatively rare. Of course, it would depend on the kind of intervention you're doing ERCP for. And as I move on with the lecture, there'll be some patients that are at higher risk for pancreatitis and other complications, and some having lower risk. So to understand the complexity of your procedure, then you would have better idea on the potential risk of complications. So nowadays, we should remember that ERCP should be primarily a therapeutic procedure. So we should try to avoid ERCP as a diagnostic procedure as much as possible. Nowadays, we have a lot of options to image the biliary tract, including MRCP as well as EUS. So for diagnosis, I strongly encourage you to use these other modalities and not ERCP. Then, of course, you need to choose the right patients, use the correct techniques, and have early recognition of complications and their management. So, of course, as I've mentioned, it's best to know more before ERCP. MRCP is a very good way of imaging the biliary tract. It allows you to assess both the bile ducts as well as the soft tissue around the area. EUS, as an endoscopist, many of us are now equipped with the technique of EUS. So in patients where you have high suspicion of the need of ERCP intervention, you can first perform a EUS, gain some understanding of the anatomy, followed by ERCP. So in some patients, most of the time in our patients, when we do ERCP, it's mainly for common bile duct stones. If you don't have the luxury of the availability of MRCP, like a lot of public hospitals in Hong Kong, then sometimes you still need to go by the other parameters like liver functions as well as ultrasound. So this is one of the paper published in GIE 2010 saying the likelihood of presence of a bile duct stones based on liver function as well as ultrasound imaging. So in patients with deranged liver function and also dilated duct on ultrasound, the probability of a stone is quite high. Whereas in the patients with a abnormal liver function but no normal ducts, then these are moderate risks of common bile duct stones. So these are the patients that are truly indicated for either MRCP or EUS. So I'm going to focus more on these potential adverse events of the ERCP and how to avoid them. We mentioned pancreatitis, bleeding, perforation, and also particular risk during technique of stone removal, trap basket. For pancreatitis, this is one of the areas where the endoscopist is most feared of, because when it happens, it's very much out of our hands. When it happens, we can just give supportive care. And particularly if the patient is coming in for, came in for elective procedure, or if they have pancreatic cancer waiting for surgery, if this happens, then there'll be significant delays in terms of the discharge as well as surgery. Again, ERCP, there's a famous saying that ERCP is most dangerous to those who need it the least. So if you look at all the pre-procedural risk factors for PEP, sphincter of Auddy dysfunction, which some of us believe it does have, this does occur, but many of us also don't think this is an indication. Patient, female patient, normal size duct, young age, history of PEP, pancreatic diffusum, and also if the patient is a lawyer, these are all thought to be a risk factor for both ERCP pancreatitis. There are some procedures that are particularly prone for PEP, including pancreatic sphincterotomy, more than 8 cannulation attempts, pancreatic injections, particularly forceful injections resulting in the visualization of side branches, pancreatic duct instrumentation like stone extraction, ampullectomy, and balloon sphincteroplasty. So this is a patient who had a slightly difficult biliary cannulation. And a wire was inserted into the PD. And then we decided to try for a double guide wire technique. So with the guide wire in the PD, we tried to cannulate at a different direction. You see the catheter pointing towards at the 12 o'clock area. We used the angle tip VisiGlide guide wire, and then it went to the into the bile duct. So In this patient, I thought it was the number of pancreatic cannulation was not a lot. So, and there was no injection of contrast into PD. So I decided to remove the PD wire and perform a sphincterotomy with stone extraction. I also performed a sphincteroplasty because the duct was quite dilated. And I think the stone was probably a larger stone. And afterwards, I removed the stones with a balloon. And then afterwards, of course, my decision of not to insert a PD stent was wrong, and the patient suffered from mild pancreatitis. So what are the methods that we can employ to avoid, to potentially avoid this happening in our patients? There are many ways. One is a pharmacological methods to reduce post-PEP, post-ERCP pancreatitis. Rectal endomethacin is one of the best way to reduce PEP. It's cheap, it's easily available, and it has proven by many studies to be useful. So in this landmark study in 2012, Elmuza suggested that rectal endomethacin 100 milligrams immediately after ERCP may be beneficial. And they recruited patients who have either one of these issues, SOD, history of PEP, precursor sphincterotomy, sphincteroplasty, more than 8 cannulation technique attempts, ampullectomy, and or patients with more than or equal to 2 minor criteria, which include all of these. So in this landmark study, they found that the use of rectal intermethacid after ERCP reduced all post ERCP pancreatitis by around 10%. And also the risk of GI bleeding is not significantly different between the two arms. In another study, assessing a similar drug, diclofenac, Voltaren. If we give Voltaren after ERCP, it seems to be able to provide a similar protective effect in terms of the overall pancreatitis rate. In all patients, the diclofenac group only have 7 patients versus 17 in the control group. And this is similar for all patients with a sphincterotomized patient, as well as non-SOD patients. Then there's this study published in Lancet, looking at 2 ways of giving rectal intermethacin. So should we give rectal intermethacin for every patient, or should we be selective and give rectal intermethacin in those patients which we think have high risk of post-ERCP pancreatitis? So universal rectal endomethacin versus selective rectal endomethacin. So it also very interesting, this study, because they show that if we give universal pre-procedural endomethacin, the pancreatitis rate is as low as 4% versus a selective rectal in the method in high-risk patient. So by this universal method, we can reduce the pancreatitis rate to around less than half of the initial percentage. And in high-risk patient, it can also reduce the rate of pancreatitis again by around 50%. So this is very significant. So meaning, perhaps because rectal endomethacin is so cheap and easily available, this should be provided, as this should be considered as the standard of care and be given in all patients undergoing ERCP. So there are some studies that also look at other medications. And in this study, they look at addition of 5 milligrams of sublingual isosorbent dinitrite versus rectal endomethacin alone. So again, interestingly, they were able to show that the combination of a 5-MG sublingual dinitrate can reduce the rate of pancreatitis by around half, and the relative risk of reduction was 56%, and absolute risk reduction was 8.6%. Another group from Buxman looked at the use of aggressive fluid hydration. So by aggressive, it means they want to give 3 cc's per kilogram per hour during procedure, plus a bolus of 20 cc's per kilogram immediately after procedure, and then continuing the IV fluid for another 8 hours. So I am around 70 kilograms. If you give 3 cc's, around 210 cc's per hour. So for one day, you are looking at around almost 4 liters. So 4 liters, that's quite a lot. So obviously we need to exclude patients which cannot tolerate this sort of aggressive fluid hydration. But they were able to show with aggressive hydration, there was 0% patient suffering from acute pancreatitis. It was significantly different. And the total fluids during the 4 hours was almost 4 liters. So this is the main limitation of this, this method. Okay, how about during the procedure, how can we reduce the risk of post-ERCP pancreatitis? Just now, previous speakers have mentioned that the use of guide wire instead of contrast-guided cannulation can reduce the risk of pancreatitis. So by not injecting contrast, we avoid the risk of injected contrast into the PD. So this can reduce the risk of PEP by around 3 times. So this is from a meta-analysis. So by using a guide wire technique, this is another patient with a double guide wire technique. So first, the PD was cannulated and a guide wire placed. This was followed by a double guide wire technique. And this technique is also important because it allows us to have a pulse the ampulla straight and also gives us some idea on where the papilla is potentially is. And with this technique, we know where the papilla, where the opening for the CBD is, then we can confidently cannulate the CBD, followed by insertion of a guide wire without injection of contrast. And by this way, the guide wire goes in quite smoothly. All right, so sometimes it may not be always possible. So this is another patient with a difficult cannulation. So here you can see the papilla is located in the diverticulum. My scope position is very awkward. So it's sort of like a in between a short and a long loop position. So by changing my scope position, I'm moving into a long, semi-long position. Right here, the papilla seems to be in a more favorable position for cannulation. So I try to cannulate again with the guide wire. So it seems like after some manipulation, I was able to have the catheter deeper. I was not able to advance my wire, so I, without much choice, I had to inject a bit of contrast and see how I can manipulate the guide wire. And after having the guide wire in the PD, Using this as a fulcrum, I reduce my scope very slowly. And with the guy wire here, because I want to free myself from the papilla, so I decided to insert a PD stent. So this helps to stabilize the papilla as well as potentially reduce the chance of pancreatitis. And afterwards, I was able to cannulate with a wire guided technique deeply in the CBD. And these are two cases where the cannulation was a bit difficult. And although it also illustrates what we can do to help with our cannulation as well as prevention of pancreatitis. So placement of pancreatic stent. The rationale is after repeated cannulation of PD, the insertion of PD stent can help us define an anatomy, allow better movements of the endoscope, as well as reduce the risk of pancreatitis. So in this meta-analysis, it has shown that the use of PD stent significantly reduces PEP in multiple studies. The idea is the PD stent can allow passage of the pancreatic juice through the pancreatic duct opening, even after repeated cannulation, resulting in edema and swelling of the PD orifice. So then people started asking, is there a role in adding what we know in terms of the pharmacological prophylaxis with PD stents? So retinal intermethacid, sublingual isosorbate nitritride, IV fluids plus PD stent versus pharmacological prophylaxis alone. So in this study published in Endoscopy 2019, actually, there was no difference between the rate of PEP of pharmacological methods versus PD stent, plus PD stent versus pharmacological prophylaxis alone. So that makes you think, if we are very well prepared for the patient, is there a role in further inserting this PD stent? So providing a summary, recommendations to prevent PEP. So definitely universal pre-procedural rectal endomethacid should be considered. In those patients who can tolerate aggressive fluid hydration, then you may consider providing this as well. And in terms of PD stent, it may be more useful if you are not employing all these other methods of preventing PEP. And of course, don't forget all the other cannulation techniques. Try to keep the number of cannulation attempts as low as possible, restricting the number of PD guide wire, use of a precut sphincterotomy, the needle knife fistulotome should be the preferred technique, and avoid a small balloon endoscopic balloon dilatation. So apart from pancreatitis, of course, there are other risks of complications. For example, perforations. These can be classified into either luminal wall perforation, sphincterotomy induced perforation, guide wire perforation, or just retroperitoneal air. So retroperitoneal air can be seen in the CT like this. In most cases, this condition is self-limiting, so probably won't need to worry too much. If you want, you may fast the patient for a few days, just give them antibiotics, and they should be okay to eat after a few days. Whereas in this condition, there's a instrument-associated bile duct perforation. So you can see a lot of filling defects, stones, and on injection contrast, it's actually not the common bile duct, and we had to go in to operate, and interestingly, there was a hole in the common bile duct. How about scope induced perforation. And most of the time, these are big perforations, so it is recommended to close this perforation. So you can see there's a scope induced perforation right here. And with the use of Ovesco, usually if you recognize this perforation early on, then closure would be quite secure. This sort of scope perforation usually happens during the reduction of the scope. So when you reduce the scope, there's a paradoxical movement of the scope downwards. So particularly for those who are starting to learn the procedure, this can happen. So right here, you can see I was using the twin grasper. So there were two sides. I could grasp two sides of the mucosa. And then help to pull the two sides of the mucosa into the channel of the scope. So after grasping both sides, we pull the device close into the channel, and then we fire the Ovesco. And then this is what it looks like after removal of the cap, so a secure closure. Okay. And very rarely we would see a post sphincterotomy perforation. Most of the time, these, if you can insert a plastic stent, this would be okay. Of course, there's also description of a insertion of a metal stent to seal the perforation site. And I think both are adequate means of ensuring a sealing of the perforation site. Bleeding after sphincterotomy is happens sometimes. Torrential bleeding is uncommon. So if there's a lot of bleeding, sometimes it can happen after ampullectomy. So the general principles would still be the same. So there's a number of risk factors like patients with coagulopathy, cirrhosis, cholangitis. Of course, patients, if they have significant cirrhosis, you need to be aware sometimes it's not only from the sphincterotomy, it can be coming from inside the bowel duct. So portal bileopathy, in particular in India, which Nagi could later tell us more, this condition is much more common. So in terms of treatment of sphincterotomy bleeding, mostly self-limiting. So for me, most importantly is to have a guide wire in the bowel duct. If there is some bleeding, then we can start by putting some pressure with the balloon. If this doesn't help, then we'll start injection around the bleeding site. If it's after sphincterotomy, it's most commonly at the apex of the sphincterotomy. So we could inject around that area, followed by the use of something more definite, like the coagulation grasper. If bleeding is very severe, then you may consider the use of metal stents as well. In very rare cases, embolization may be something that you would need to finally resort to. So another interesting complications is basket entrapment. So this could happen when we try to engage a really big and hard stone. Although you can, when you first start perform ERCP, you may be too aggressive or enthusiastic, and you overestimate the size of a stone that you can take out from the papilla. So you cannot do so, then the stone might become very stuck at the basket, and you are neither here nor there. So with the basket stuck at the stone, then it will be trapped in the bowel duct. And in the past, we would resort to surgery, but nowadays there are other methods of trying to get out from this situation. First of all, try not to overestimate yourself. For stones that are very big, I would suggest you to consider the performance of a large balloon dilatation with orthotic sphincterotomy. So previously we have published a study on examining the use of combined small sphincterotomy plus large balloon sphincteroplasty. So by large balloon sphincteroplasty, we're talking about 12 millimeters or more. So this is useful in ducts that are dilated and large. You can see a big balloon, and particularly useful for stones that are big. So you can see afterwards, there's a big opening, which allows removal of the stone. So in this study published by us in Gastroenterology 2013, we noted that if you use a large balloon sphincteroplasty, the rate of mechanical lithotripsy is significantly decreased, particularly for larger stones. And this is important technique that you should perform. Also, please be consider the use of a BML in very large stones, because this can get you out of, prevent the trap basket from happening. Because the BML can help you fragment larger stones. If you encounter this trap basket situation, then the method to get out of this situation is to use this Sohendra metal sheath. So this is a cut basket. The wire is attached to this pulley system. We would insert a metal sheath on the wire first, and we will slowly crush with this device the basket against the metal sheath, resulting or helping you to get out of this trap basket situation. Of course, nowadays we have also other gadgets. If that Sohendra stone retriever cannot help you, then you can also consider the use of spyglass. So this is a stone that is trapped in the basket. We cannot pull it out, and we cannot free the stone. So as a result, we have to cut the wire, remove the scope. We try to use the stone lithotripsy, but it didn't work. Another way is to use a BML to try and capture this stone over the basket, and then also didn't work. So we decided to push the stone back up into the bowel duct to give us more space, and then insert the spyglass. And then once we can see the stone, we can fragment the stone.
Sorry. Hello, fracture. Anthony. Because
yeah,
of
I'm
time.
Almost finishing, so
yes.
1 or 2 minutes. Thank you. Sorry. So, in conclusion, ERCP is a safe and low risk procedure. And adverse events is best managed by prevention and judicious care in performing the procedure. So sorry for going over time. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony. It was comprehensive and covered all aspects of complications and how can we deal with those situations. The live team is waiting. So I think it's time for us to move to live endoscopy room. There are several questions on the chatting window, Q&A window, but during live, if there is opportunity, we will touch those questions. Thank you, Anthony. Now it's time to call the endoscopy room. Nagi and Sundeep, are you there?
Yeah, we are here.
Perfect.
Now the stage is yours.
Uh,
Hi, good evening from Hyderabad. Again, on behalf of the organizers, we'd like to thank WEO Pancreatic Ability team and of course Lars and Dong-Wan there for a fantastic job and giving us this opportunity to transmit from Hyderabad. I'm Nageshwar Reddy, and along with me is Sundeep and of course Santosh, who's head of anesthesia. We'll be demonstrating at least two cases, probably three if we have time, of different types of cannulation, biliary cannulation, pancreatic cannulation, and we have a case, if time permits, who has a difficult cannulation. The cannulation was tried in different cities elsewhere. It was not successful, so we asked him to come for this course. So we'll start with the first case now, which we'll be demonstrating. It is a patient, 60-year-old female patient, a diabetic, presented with recurrent episodes of cholangitis. The LFT was abnormal, an MRCP showed the stones in the common hepatic duct. You can see in the common bile duct, there are two stones. The gallbladder also stones. The plan in this case today is to do an ERCP, selective CBD cannulation, and clearance of the bile duct stones. Now, when I start this case, is it Dong-Wan or Lars? Somebody was, shall we go ahead?
Yes, Nagi, please go ahead. Yes,
okay.
We are watching.
Okay, so
we are
enjoying first of all, I thank you. So I want to show the patient position because we are assuming that this is going to be watched by many gastroenterologists who are starting ERCP. We like to keep our patient on prone or semi-prone position like this here before the intubation. I'm using a side viewing endoscope, which is from Olympus in this case, to intubate. I'll start first to show the different steps in this quickly. So I'm passing it over the tongue here and then go into the esophagus. When I go into the esophagus, the mucosa is sliding across. I don't see the lumen much. This is because it's side viewing. And as I go down, I go to the GE junction. And when I get to the GE junction, at this point, I'll make my small knob up like this. And when I do that, I'll see the lumen of the esophagus. Now, I just want to see if any pathology is there, the lumen, nothing. It's clear. I just go into the stomach. And when I pop into the stomach like this, I'll turn my body to the left, go towards the fundus and try and aspirate all the secretions there because this patient is on propofol. I don't want her to aspirate. Okay, then I finish that job. Then I turn back to the straight position. And this point of time, I inflate air to see the stomach as it's going down. Now, here, what I'll again do is I'll turn my MIG knob up so the scope becomes a straight scope now and then pass it down, going towards the pyloric region. You can see the pylorus in the distance. You can see the pylorus there. And what I'll do is I'll push my scope down towards the pylorus in a little semi-blind way. But when I actually get near the pylorus, I want to actually use this technique of called the sunsetting sign, where I'll go approach the pylorus and then turn this straight, big knob straight. And as I do that, the scope tends to slip into the duodenum. See that? It slips into the duodenum. And when it's, what I'll then do is I'm in the duodenal cap. I'll turn the small knob right, fix it, then push my scope down a little. And as I push the scope down, I can see the second part of the duodenum. Now, when I get into the second part of the duodenum, I want to see the papilla now. There's a specific maneuver here, which I'll do. Actually, three maneuvers together, which will help me to get the scope down. If I can have the fluoroscopy also, so we'll have all the three pictures. You can see I put my small knob right, fixed it. I turn my body to the right. The big knob is turned up like this, and then I start pulling the scope back. As I start doing this, you can see that it has moved down. And I get right at the papilla and form a hockey stick or J-shaped scope. I'll pull back the scope here to see the papilla now. Now that's the papilla there, papillary or papilla. I want to get selectively into the bile duct. So I'll now, for selective cannulation, I like to use a spintrotome. I'm using a clever cut spintrotome for Olympus in this case. I very rarely use a regular cannula, the spintrotome, because with the spintrotome, you can bend the spintrotome, you can straighten it, and you can move it so that you can actually direct it in the direction you want. Now, in the spintrotome is a wire. Here, I'm using a VisiGlide wire, always an angled VisiGlide wire to start with cannulation, or a Terumo wire. I'm putting a sphincterotome down now, the biopsy channel. Always wire guided, we start with first. This has been explained in earlier talks, why wire guided. And also, like Anthony explained, reduce the chance of pancreatitis. Now, my sphincterotome has come up now. I'm going to now go towards the so-called biliary direction here. So now I can see some material coming out here. So I'll aim my sphincterotome up there towards the so-called bile duct region. Bend it a little. Can you bend a little? And then we'll see if the wire goes in into the bile duct. Mm-hmm. Pass the wire. Can you see the fluoroscopy picture? Yeah, fluoro. See that now? So I specifically directed it 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock position into the bile duct position.
It looks like the ampulla was waiting for your digit.
Dong-Wan, you're not able to hear you well.
We're
not able to hear you well. Can you come back again, Dong-Wan?
This ampulla, you are really, fantastic to do the cannulation by just one attempt without any repeated cannulation prior. So,
but most papilla are friendly to us. They are difficult ones, which come once in a way where we do a pre-cut. Mm-hmm. So what we'll do now is I'm now going to inject some contrast to delineate the CBD. Inject. Can you fluoroscopy? Yeah. So can you, inject. I'm not seeing anything now. Yeah. Now I think in the bottom part, can you see the stones now? I'll just push my scope down. I'm starting to see the scope.
Yes, you can see some stones in the distal CBD.
You can see the distal CBD, two stones are there. Now we'll have to cut that. I can see filling defect there. One definitely above and little irregular area below. I'm going to use the sphincterotome to cut. We'll flex the wire, keep only one third of the wire inside, and then cut. Use a blended current.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see now, already we are starting to get. So the question now is whether to only do a sphincterotomy or a balloon. Now you can see how I'm doing the sphincterotomy. Just observe that I put my wire only one third inside. I'm using the elevator to pull the sphincterotome up, and I'm using the shaft to control my sphincterotomy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just pulling back on my shaft.
What is your upper margin generally?
So I generally go up to the edge here. Depending upon the size of the bile duct, the stones that have to be removed, I'd make a cut based on that. In this case, there's a little ooze. We don't have to worry because once we finish removing all the stones, we'll have a look at that to see if it requires any treatment.
Mm-hmm. So choosing to do a cut only or extend it by a balloon, do you have like a cutoff size of the stones where you would prefer to balloon dilate?
Yeah, that's a good question. What normally if the stone is above 12 millimeters, I always use a balloon in addition to sphincterotomy. But these stones are the size less than the size of the endoscope. So they were probably about 1 centimeter in size. In these cases, I'll just do a sphincterotomy first. If I can't get these stones out, I might add a balloon later on. But I think the chance of getting this would be quite good just with a plain sphincterotomy. So 12 millimeters and above, I'll do a balloon sphincteroplasty in addition.
Yeah.
But that time, I won't do such a full sphincterotomy. I do a partial sphincterotomy and then do a balloon sphincteroplasty. Lars, any difference with you?
No, exactly the same. Yes.
So I'm now passing a stone extraction balloon up there and then see if I can go above this. You can see the fluoroscopy now. There are two stones. One of the stone is right up there, but I'll try and get the lower one first and then go for the top one. So the balloon is going through. I'll inflate the balloon in the mid part of the CBD, just above the suspected lower stone. I'll inflate the balloon. Then pull the balloon back. You can see I'm pulling the balloon back here. And then what I'll do is I'll do a series of movements. Again, very important to observe. We can slightly decrease the balloon size. The balloon is very large. Mm-hmm. Slightly decrease the balloon size. Yeah. So what I'll do is I'll hold the balloon with my left hand here and then push the scope down and turn right. When I do that, the balloon comes out in the direction of CBD. You can see the stone coming out? You can see the stone coming out. So I'll do this so that the balloon comes out in the direction of the CBD. We'll have to decrease the balloon size a little more. Yeah, now you can see the stone which is coming out, but just again to show that to you better. Yeah, so the balloon has come out, the stone has come out. Now I'll go to the stone on the top now. So the stone on the top is the one which was a little larger, but hopefully it'll come out too. Now, can you see the ERCP? Now you can see the image. The balloon size should come down a little because it's too large. Mm-hmm. And then we get the stone down. And then again, as I come back, I'll again do the same maneuver. Get the balloon right up to the papilla, right up to the papilla, and then use this movement to try and get this out. Now I'm just using the twisting movement to get the balloon out. The balloon and the stone should come out together here. So I'm finding a little resistance here, but let me just see. Yeah, now you can see the stone popping out slowly there. Sometimes it's better to have a little patience because it's like a breech delivery. It comes very slowly, but it'll come out.
Mm-hmm.
Now there is some heme here, so you can't see very well. I'll just flush that out and then show you the. So, I'm finding it a little more difficult. Ah, now it's come out. Now it's come out.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So, now it's all cleared up. So, what I'm going to do is very important. I have to do an occlusion cholangiogram to demonstrate that everything is clear there. Now, how do I do that? I'll use partial inflation of the balloon, not complete, partial inflation. They go up there. Inflate the balloon. And then as I come down, you see I keep injecting contrast to show that the CBD is completely clear. Okay? Yeah, now I'm getting it down. So what I'll do is after this procedure is over, I will just wait for a second, look at the bleeding point and see if I have to tamper it or inject some epinephrine. Yeah. The balloon down. So I'm coming out now, and what I'll do is I'll wash this area with some normal saline. And
during
then,
Anthony's talk, there was question about like this case, if you see bleeding after EST, what kind of steps are you using for the bleeding control? Firstly, wash and rinse.
Yeah.
And then see the bleeding amount and then balloon.
Yeah. So what I do is I'll first wash and then I'll, if necessary, if there's some ooze there, I'll use some epinephrine to inject in the site.
Mm-hmm.
And then if I can actually see any active spurter, I like to use a co-op grasper. And still if it's not under control, then I'll just put a completely covered stent temporarily. But this is, you can see a very small ooze here, which will eventually stop it. Yeah.
Very little. I just one comment as well, because sometimes when you're doing your sphincterotomy, you get a bleed. And then I think it's important to continue your cut until you're complete, because your cut, your bleeding is already there. So stopping the cut is not a good idea.
That's a very important point. You have to continue cutting, because if you stop, then it may be partial retraction of the vessel. You have to continuously keep cutting the. So what now we are doing, I washed it a little. Looks like the bleed has already stopped. I'll now take an epinephrine injection and at the apex of the papilla, I'll give some epinephrine injection. This is often causing spasm of the vessels which come on the top. I'm using a Carlock needle for this. This is a very special needle, which can be used through the side wing scope. But the regular needles are difficult to use sometimes. You can see the two stones there. Yeah, regular needles are sometimes difficult to use, but the bleed has already almost stopped, but just for my satisfaction, and to keep, so out, needle out. So the needle is out. So what I'll do is I'll go to the apex here where the suspected bleed is, inject.
So you, you put the to needle out while keeping the elevator down, right? Before
exactly. The yeah, otherwise the needle doesn't come out. Although in car lock, it's okay. Sometimes you get it out, but mostly. So I'm mostly going to the apex there where the suspected bleed is, and then I'm going to inject. Inject. And then we'll wash it with epinephrine also. Inject a little more. Stop. I think the bleed has stopped now, and you can see the two stones here. Okay?
Yes.
Yes. Dong-Wan, you're happy? Lars, okay?
Thank you.
Very happy.
Yeah, so I think we'll go on to the next case where Sundeep is waiting with the case now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sundeep, you are on.
Hi. So can we have the history now? So this is a 28-year-old male with chronic calcific pancreatitis and recurrent pain abdomen, and he's diabetic also because of his chronic pancreatitis. Because of his recent pain, we investigated him, and you see that he has a large stone in the pancreatic head for which he underwent two sessions of lithotripsy, extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. And the plan is now to do an ERCP, clear the fragments, and place a pancreatic stent. So before I start, I would like to show you the X-ray of this patient, the current X-ray, if they have a fluoroscopy image. And we have the fluoroscopy image on the screen. So the technician is pointing to the small multiple fragments of stone on the right of the spine. So these are the fragments which are left in the duct, which is what I will remove. So I'm using an Olympus 180 scope, the V scope. And I'll pass the same way, like Dr. Reddy did, behind the tongue for opening it. Yes.
So there was a question, Sandeep, about positioning of the patient. If they are intubated, do you prefer prone or supine position for the ERCP itself?
So we do everything on a prone position if the cameraman can focus on the patient on the back. So just like for the biliary ERCP, we're also doing for the pancreatic ERCP. The patient is prone. He's wrapped like a salad because of the COVID risk. And there's only one hole which is left through which the scope passes, and that is the little airtight area. And he has a nasal prongs to take care of oxygen. And we have Dr. Harina, the senior anesthetist, who's taking care of the anesthesia part. So we'll go exactly like what Dr. Reddy showed. Along the greater curve, we slide the scope, looking at the pylorus. And once we reach there, we go using the sun setting sign, enter the duodenum. At this point, we can see some erythema on the duodenum, which is because of the recent shockwave. So this is a minor papilla that you see there. As I pass down, it's also quite prominent.
Yes.
Yeah.
And sometimes in chronic pancreatitis, minor papilla also helps in excreting the pancreatic juice. So both ducts are helping out. This patient does not have divisum, but the minor papilla is also helping in passing the juice into the duodenum. And I'm now shortening the scope. Can I have the hand movement here once again? And the fluoroscope image. So this is almost a semi-long, and then I turn right and pull back. And the papilla actually was quite open. The orifice was quite open. And that's the advantage of ESWL. When these stones pass, they cause a little bit of traumatic opening of the mind of the papillary orifice. I'm also using the cannula from Olympus, the clever cut, which is loaded with a thermo guide wire.
Mm-hmm.
So you said you did an ERCP a week ago or something, right?
But you did not
use sphincterotomy at the time. Why not?
That time the stone was blocking the filling of the duct. So we just filled the terminal most part, the prepapillary area, but rest of the duct was not filled because of the obstructing stone.
Okay.
So hopefully we should be able to now negotiate beyond that because the stone has been pulverized. And I'm...
But because some experts suggest that you can do the sphincterotomy and then the ESWL and then just wait for spontaneous
expulsion of the fragments.
Yes, that's another way of looking at ESW of chronic pancreatitis management, that we do a sphincterotomy first followed by ESW or vice versa. In our unit, we practice first breaking the stones and then doing ERCP and sphincterotomy and try to remove as many fragments which are left behind and also place a stent since we manipulate the sphincter.
Okay.
Only thing, we don't try to be too much aggressive in sphincterotomy because the papilla is quite edematous after ESWL. So now I'm trying to cannulate the pancreatic duct. So unlike CBD, the PD is quite perpendicular to my duodenum scope. So I have to go perpendicular to the wall. And this is what I'm trying to do. Gently enter. Yeah, I look to be anchored inside. I'll pass a guide wire. See how the wire has gone into the PD. That's fine. It's quite dilated because the guide wire has taken a loop. And if it's not the CBD, I hope. Yeah, it's taking a pancreatic.
Yes.
So now we are inside the pancreatic duct. And I'll go a little deeper in, Okay, withdraw the wire, please. And inject some contrast now.
Mm-hmm.
So you see the duct is hugely dilated, which was not getting filled pre-ESWL. Can you pass the guide wire not deep down? Thank you, Naresh. So I'll go as deep as possible, trying to straighten my guide wire. So that's nicely done. You can exchange for a termo wire to a regular wire. So we'll use a VisiGlide.
Any specific guide wires you prefer in the pancreas? Straight, angled, to remove what?
So we use a guide wire which has both hydrophilic and the regular thing. So that the hydrophilic wire part goes inside, but here we had loaded the Teremo already, so I didn't want to change that. Now we have the regular, the VisiGlide going deep in. I'm withdrawing my sphincterotome back. And as I withdraw back, I'll request Naresh to please inject some more in the head. Yeah, so that's nicely done. That's stop. And we'll do a sphincterotomy now, the pancreatic sphincterotomy. So the sphincter is cut between 1 and 3 o'clock, but with the guide wire inside, we're cutting only the pancreatic sphincter. And as we cut, we expect some stone fragments and proteinaceous plugs to come out, but it'll not be as aggressive like in a biliary sphincterotomy because of the risk of bleed of already inflamed papilla. Okay, so here comes the juice.
So while you're cutting, do you ever worry about vascular calcifications or other sort of damage to adjacent tissues with the ESWL?
Yes, there is always a trauma, a collateral injury to the neighboring organs, including skin and the subcutaneous tissue around, and the soft tissue around the duodenum and the pancreatic head. Sometimes patients also complain of pain. I think this should be okay. Or maybe we can do a little bit more cut to see the stone fragments coming out.
Yeah.
Instead of cutting all through the length, you are cutting just a little and check the direction and cut again and check the direction. Is it your usual way?
I'm sorry, Dong-Wan, I could not hear you well. The patient is snoring deeply, so I...
when we do EPST or EST, we can do just one big cut or we can do little by little. Which method do you prefer?
So when the papilla is inflamed, I'm a little more cautious. And in pancreatic duct, if it starts bleeding, which is much more likely than a biliary sphincterotomy, the bleeding can be sometimes more. So we are more gentle and cautious.
Yes.
Our aim is to do a sphincterotomy and place a stent. I'll also pass a balloon now to just drain out some of the, extract some of the stones, although my cut is not hugely big. At a follow-up ERCP about 3 months later when he comes back, at that time we can do more liberal sphincterotomy because then the inflammation part is taken care of, will not be there at that time.
I agree. Staged approach would be a better way.
Because anyway, I'll be placing a stent, and at second session, if we can do a more liberal sphincterotomy and then clear up the duct, if the stones have not passed on their own. So I'm passing a balloon, which I'll inflate. Naresh, please inflate. Not so much, a little bit. That's it. Okay.
Do you ever find a need for spyglass stone fragmentation, or do you always fragment with the ESWL?
Lars, we are heavily dependent on ESWL. We hardly ever do on spyglass. That's it. We'll put a place as 10, 7, 10. So you always do ESWL.
Mm-hmm.
That's our area of interest and expertise. We don't want to change unless there is no reason to do a lithotripsy, external shockwave lithotripsy in a patient. Only then we rely on the spyglass laser or EHA lithotripsy.
Mm.
I will now place a stent, and the stent that we use for pancreatic stent duct is a single pigtail stent where the pigtail is in the duodenum, which prevents it to migrate inside the bile duct into the pancreatic duct, and the tip is straight with a flap. And this stent has a radiopaque marker which tells us where the positioning should be. I have selected a 7 French 10 centimeter single pigtail stent, a plastic stent, which is coming now. So this is a flap, the inner end, and this goes in. The placement of the stent is quite similar. Multiple side holes are there, which also help in draining the pancreatic juice. Here goes the radiopaque marker, as you can see in fluoroscopy as well. And now you can remove the wire. I'll keep a pressure here and then release the stent.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Do you ever see pancreatitis following this fierce handling of the pancreas?
Yes, if you are very aggressive at filling the ducts or manipulating the duct, pancreas is less forgiving compared to bile duct. But but fortunately, the chronic pancreatitis is still more forgiving than the normal pancreatic duct. So we do a sphincterotomy and try not to inject too vigorously. Do a bare minimum evaluation of the duct which is required, and then place a stent.
Yeah.
I think that completes my procedure. I will suck out the gastric content.
Thank you, Sundeep. And
thank you, Lars and Dong-Wan.
Yeah, Nagi and yourself did very easy cannulation for us to see. I think you are great. So we need to see one more case.
Yeah. Okay, Dong-Wan, we have one more. If we have time, we have one more case. This is a 49-year-old male patient presented with right hypochondral pain. There's no history of jaundice, but bilirubin is slightly elevated. Alphas and enzymes are elevated. MRCP picture will show. Can you show dilated CBD with a smooth terminal stricture? The PD looks all right. This patient actually had several attempts at ERCP in other city. They couldn't cannulate the bile duct. So it's a difficult case. You wanted a difficult case, so I thought we should put a difficult case. Let's see if we'll succeed with your help from there. Okay. So the purpose here is to try and see if I can selectively get into the bile duct, which I'm not very sure. So I'm using the same sphincterotome. Mr. Srinivas, my technician, is this time using a Terumo wire. If you can focus on his hand. The reason is because this has been cannulation attempted several times, they couldn't go in. So I want to use a more friendly wire to get into the bile duct. So for this, we like to use an angle Terumo wire because you can manipulate it easily. So what I'll do is I'm going with my sphincterotome, placing it at the site where expected bile duct is. Can you see? I'm just bending it a little so that he can get a proper direction. And then we'll try and see if you can. Yeah. Now, Srinivas. So I'm just hooking it up there towards the CBD and seeing if we can get in now. He's finding some resistance. It's gone in. Oh, God. It's gone in.
Oh. I was
So I was thinking because he had at least 3 attempts in hospitals outside elsewhere. This will be a difficult case. And we could select this for you. But unfortunately, we can't show a pre-cut in this because we're inside. So we'll ask Srinivas to inject some contrast and he'll change the wire to a regular wire. The reason we use Teremo, as I told you, because we expected it to be difficult. So in difficult cases, my suggestion is use the short Teremo with angle tip. Your technician can manipulate it very well.
I think the coordination between the endoscopist and the assistant is very important.
Yeah, exactly.
So, but to be blessed with assistants like yourself, Nagi, is not for everyone, I think.
Yeah, that we have an advantage of, we've got some very good assistants. I think we're filling up the CBD here. There's short terminal structure. There's some sort of, I can't see a stone, but there's some, probably a little sludge. Can we inject a little more? We'll magnify that picture on screen. Inject a little more. Yeah. Can you show me the picture? Magnified picture. Lower end, there's a stricture here. We can see that.
Yeah.
And this is the one. And there's some dilatation above. I'm not sure. There's some sludge. We'll do a sphincterotomy now. And again, to show you the technique, I'm going away a little from papilla, keeping 1/3 of my sphincterotome inside. This is a clever cut sphincterotome. You can see the plastic sheath here, which is nicely covering 2/3. Now you can, the camera can focus totally on me and show my hands. My face is not necessary, not so good looking. So my hands and this part. Yeah. So then what you see, how I'm manipulating with the elevator up, I'm pushing the sphincterotome up and then manipulating my shaft, leaning my body towards the left a little. And then using an endocut current and carefully following this. So I don't get a zipper cut. I'm also cutting the inner part a little more now. And then I adjust. When I come to this stage, I sort of go inside, adjust, and then come back a little. And then again, do the same process. I can go right up to the end there. Yeah. Okay. So that is, I think, a complete sphincterotomy. Now, like my sphincterotome goes in quite easily. It looks like the terminal part is little sort of narrowed there, but not as bad as we expected.
Yeah.
So what we'll do is we'll leave the guide wire in place. I'll come back with a balloon, do a sweep, and I feel the pathology, I think Lars and Dong-Wan, if you agree with me, looks like pathology is the terminal part here, just at the papilla and above. There is the tissue looks very hyperplastic here, very abnormal.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think?
Do you think this is just a sphincter hyperplasia or anything more?
The sphincter hyperplasia is the first possibility. But if that was the case, I would have expected the pancreatic duct also to dilate. I don't see a dilated pancreatic duct here.
It's very unusual. Distal CBD narrowing.
Yeah, it's a...
Yeah. When you look at this kind of CBD from the percutaneous cholangioscopic approach, the distal sphincteric segment may show some mucosal hyperplasia. But that is not neoplastic condition. So generally, we do not need to touch this kind of stricture.
Yeah. This patient has a raised enzymes, abnormal liver enzymes, and fever with chills occasionally.
Yeah, on that part, I agree. But I don't suspect any neoplastic condition in this stricture.
Exactly. I think there's no neoplastic.
So could you call this a SOD type
No, I don't think it's SOD. There seems to be a very, maybe type 3. No, type 1 or type 1.
Type 1.
Maybe, yeah, you can call
because
it type
1. Because there is pain too?
Because there is a definite obstruction there. And my balloon is not coming out easily. I'm trying to get the balloon out. My balloon is not coming out easily. The balloon is obstructed here. See, the, can you show me the fluoroscopy? I thought I did a fairly good spintrotomy, but my balloon is not coming out. It's sort of stuck in that part.
But it did look like the narrowing was a little bit more than you cut.
Yeah. I think there's just above the papilla, just above the papilla, there's a short segment narrowing here. This could be benign, like Dong-Wan says. So now what I'll do is I'll take off, I'll release the balloon. Then I'll take some biliary biopsies from the side. We have a special biopsy forceps from Olympus, which is angled and which is good for this type of thing. I'll take a couple of biopsies and a cytology to confirm that this is only benign and temporarily put a stent inside till we get the biopsy reports.
Okay.
So this is a biopsy forceps that I'm using. This is a curved biopsy forceps that comes from Olympus. It's much easier to pass this rather than the standard biopsy forceps close. And it opens up in a very peculiar way. If you can see, no, wait. Yeah, open. See, this opens on one side. So that you can get the wall there close. That's the advantage of this. So I would recommend people who are using biliary biopsies to use this type of biopsy forceps. It's much easier to use.
What is the name of this biopsy forceps?
I'll just show you. Yeah. So this is the biopsy forceps. It's the alligator fenestrated.
Alligator fenestrated.
It's called FB45Q1. They got peculiar names in Olympus, you know, all this. FB45Q1.
Okay.
I hope we get some royalty from Olympus for all this. Open. close. So you see that very easy to use this. You know, I'm taking the biopsy deep from inside, exactly at that right spot. So I'll take one more because I got a very nice bit here and then take a quick cytology. For cytology, we like to use the infinity brush, which comes from US endoscope and then put up a stent. So I think this biopsy and cytology will tell us exactly what we are dealing with. See this very nice open. You can manipulate it very well. Close. See this. You get some good bits with this. So now I'll guess, can you give me the guide wire so that I can pass that for the cytology? I always like to take both because you increase your positivity from 40 to 70% if you have both.
Yes.
Yes.
The other option would have been, I think Dong-Wan would want us to do an endosono in this case and take endosono biopsy. But I think Sundeep was trying that, but before that I did off an ERCP.
Okay.
Because lower end, we know from literature that lower end strictures yield with US is good. But this case, there's no mass lesion. I don't think US would have given us additional benefit.
I don't think so either.
It's going to be difficult for this case.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
I think so too.
Mm.
So
will you place a stent here afterwards or do you think you opened it enough?
I didn't get you last. Can you repeat?
Will you place a stent finally or no?
Yes, I'll place stent because there's a lot of contrast still, if you can see. So what I'm going to do is quickly take cytology with the infinity brush. The advantage of infinity brush is that it's got two bristles on both sides. If you can get the brush out, I'll show that. Open. You see the brush here. It's got two black areas. Well, these are the ones which dislodge the cells. The white bristle in between is the one which captures the cells. So this is, I think, close. So I'll quickly take a brushings also from this and then place a stent. Now, what type of stent? Of course, a plastic stent because it's still undecided what it is. I'll place a double pigtail stent. The reason is I'm worried that if I place a straight stent, it may pass off here. So I'll place a double pigtail stent. Because this stent is going to be there only for a week. See that the back bristle is already seen here. The actual stricture, now you have the main one picking up the cytology cells. Okay. Close. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So, and this is over now. and then we'll quickly put a stent.
Okay.
Okay.
As I said, I prefer a double pigtail because 7-7, because then it won't migrate, and within the 3 or 4 days, we'll have an answer for what is the cause for this stricture. If it's a benign stricture, then we have to give a choice of a long-term or 1 year completely covered stent versus surgery to this patient. If it's, of course, something else, then surgery in this case. So we'll wait for the... We'll actually let you know the cytology by mail.
Mm-hmm. Good.
So I'm just putting a double pigtail. Again, for those who are beginning ERCP, the technique of double pigtail stent is a little different from the standard stents. It can be passed over the regular guide wire, but when you come to actually deploying it at the end, there's certain tricks. I'll just show you that. We go close to the papilla. It's important to go close to the papilla, not be very far off. Otherwise, the loop, see that I'm very close to the papilla. I'm pushing this both with the elevator and with my hand on the rammer tube. And when I get the mark there, we see the mark appearing soon. This is a Wilson Cook stent. When I get the mark, see the mark there? The mark, usually we mark it because unfortunately the company doesn't. Then I'll push the stent, put my elevator down, push the stent down, and then ask the assistant to withdraw the wire. And then you get a natural pigtail that forms. Okay?
Beautiful.
Yeah. Wonderful. So,
that's fantastic, Nagi.
Thank you, Lars. So we finished all the cases for today because time also is up. We have a couple of more, but the time is up. So we like to thank the WO, Sundeep, then of course Santosh and Harnath. All of us would like to thank WO for this opportunity, and hopefully we could convey certain messages in this live demonstration. So Lars and Dong-Wan, thank you very much.
Thank you.
It was a wonderful live demonstration. We enjoyed the 3 talks and also 3 cases of ERCP live.
Thank you. And before we end, I think before we end, I'd like to also call upon all the audience to look at this. The ENDO 2022, the World Congress of Endoscopy, the largest Congress of GI Endoscopy is coming up, the third one in Japan, Kyoto. This is combined with the 103 Congress of the Japanese GI Endoscopy Society. It's a huge conference with more than 100 faculty from different parts of the world. By that time, of course, we'll hopefully pass the pandemic. I suggest or request all of you to closely watch this space and, of course, register for this Congress because it will be once in a lifetime experience. So hope to see you there in Kyoto.
Thank you. Thank you very
much. This is in May 2022, yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for all the audience. I think this was a record well-attended webinar in the WEO series. And watch out for more of the webinars. I think there will be plenty during this fall.